Now, since you have already gone through the biomedical importance of proteins, so you know that proteins have a diverse functions, and most of these functions, they based on the structure of protein. When we talk about the overall structure of protein molecules, we observe four different levels of protein structure. And you can see here that these are called primary, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary structure. When we talk about the primary structure of protein, it is simply nothing but the number and the sequence of amino acid in a polypeptide chain. See, I am stressing upon the word single polypeptide chain. A single polypeptide chain where we know the number and sequence of amino acid, that which are these amino acids, they are linked by peptide linkage. You all are very well aware that protein structure is stabilized by a covalent bond that is called the peptide bond. So these amino acids, they are linked by the peptide linkage, which is a covalent bond, and simply the number and the sequence of amino acid. And remember one thing, it is a single polypeptide chain. Okay, so this single polypeptide chain, the second structure of protein is called the this is second level of protein structure is called the secondary structure. And in secondary structure, it is again a single polypeptide chain which goes in a, either it is arranged in a spiral manner, it is being folded in a spiral manner, or it may be folded in the form of sheets. When it is folded in the form of this spiral shape, then this structure. So far in primary structure, we have only the covalent bond, that is a peptide bond. Now you can see here a helical structure is in front of you, and you can see that these structure, the backbone is formed by the hydrogen bonding. Now, you all are very well aware that whenever we talk about the peptide bond is a bond which is formed between the oxygen of the carbonyl carbon and the hydrogen of the amide nitrogen. So, hydrogen bond actually stabilizes the secondary structure of protein, and when the single polypeptide chain is being coiled in a manner that it forms an helical structure, then it is called alpha helical helix, alpha helix, and the backbone is stabilized by these are, you can see here, these dotted are the hydrogen bonding. Now the hydrogen bond, you are very well aware, they are non-covalent bond, and here in this alpha helical structure, this hydrogen bond is formed between the oxygen of the carbonyl carbon and the hydrogen of the amide nitrogen. So in this helical structure, the carbonyl oxygen hydrogen bonded with the hydrogen of the amide nitrogen, four residues either in front of it or four residues behind it. So in one helix, we can see we can see that it is being stabilized by the hydrogen bonding. Okay, now that these helical structures, this is first, you should understand what is a peptide bond, because without understanding the peptide bond, we will not be able to understand how this backbone, which is being in the secondary structure, is stabilized by hydrogen bonding. So if you see here, this is a peptide bond, this is one amino acid and this is second amino acid. Now what happens, this peptide bond is formed between the carbonyl, this is carboxyl group of one amino acid and the amino group of the second amino acid. And we can see here that the one water molecule is eliminated. It is a simply a dehydration reaction. And as a result of this, a covalent bond is formed, that is called the peptide bond. Now this peptide bond, if we see this peptide bond, this is alpha carbon of one amino acid residue, this is alpha carbon of the second amino acid residue. So this is called, this area involving the peptide bond as well as the alpha carbon of one amino acid residues and the alpha carbon of the second amino acid residues is called the peptide group. Got it? This is peptide bond. This is peptide bond. But when we involve this alpha carbon and this alpha carbon, then we call it as a peptide group. So this peptide group actually is a polar group. If you see in the next picture, you can see here, Now, how we came to know that the proteins have four different level of structure? There was a technique that is called as the X-ray crystallography, and this X-ray crystallography enables us to determine the different levels of protein structure. According to this X-ray crystallography, it was observed that this is our peptide bond, that this peptide bond has a characteristics of some double bond, okay? And you can see here, we can see over here that this is this carbonyl oxygen of this carbonyl carbon has a this semi-negative charge, partial negative charge, and you can see here this amide nitrogen has a partial positive charge. So this is, this peptide group is a polar group, got it? And because of this, you can see here that it has the characteristics of the peptide bond. And since it is a partial negative charge, the oxygen of the carbonyl carbon has a partial negative charge, so it acts as an acceptor of electron. And this nitrogen of the amide group has a positive charge, so it is a donor of the hydrogen atom, okay? So this is oxygen as an acceptor and nitrogen as a donor. So this is, this participate in the hydrogen bonding, which we have seen in the secondary structure of protein. And in the secondary structure of protein, there are two type of examples. We have, you have already seen the alpha helical structure. Okay, now this is one more thing what I should explain you, that this double bond, as I told you, that this peptide bond is a covalent bond, which is a bond between the two amino acids. Now remember one thing, I am using the word residue. When I say residue, it means now this amino acid is not an isolated entity, it is being bonded to another amino acid. Now peptide bond has two type of conformation, either it can be trans or it can be cis peptide bond. In nature, all peptide bonds, they are in the trans configuration. Now, if you see here, just concentrate on this. This is a peptide group. We have just seen that, I have told you just before, moment before, that this peptide bond and this alpha carbon of one amino acid residue and alpha carbon of the second amino acid residue, they comprise the peptide group. And you can see here that in this trans peptide group, you can see here the functional, the alpha carbons, they are at the corners. This is rectangle, which is being formed by the peptide group. And you can see in trans peptide bond, these alpha carbons, they are at the corner of the rectangle, which is formed, okay? But if you see the cis peptide bond, you can see these alpha carbons, they are very close to each other and they are not far away. So this is cis peptide bond and this is trans peptide bond. So in nature, the peptide bonds, they are of trans conformation. This is another thing, you one should know that. This is example, I will explain this later on. Now, as I told you earlier, that the alpha helix is the example of the primary structure of protein. Now, this alpha helix conformation has a particular stability because of the two reasons. Number one is that the side chain groups are quite well separated, and secondly, the each peptide link, now just concentrate on this, each peptide link is involved in two hydrogen bonds. I will explain you. Okay, so this alpha helix is one of the example of the secondary structure of protein, and as I told you that the peptide group, this participate in hydrogen bonding in two directions. You can see this is amide nitrogen, and hydrogen of this amide nitrogen, hydrogen bonds with the oxygen of the carbonyl carbon, four amino residues ahead of it. And if you can see here the oxygen of the carbonyl carbon is hydrogen bonding with the amide hydrogen on the four residues behind. So a single peptide group is hydrogen bonding four residues ahead of it and four residues behind of it. And this hydrogen bond actually stabilizes the alpha helical structure of a protein. Now in this alpha helical structure, this side chains, they are free, and every alpha helix structure at least have 11 amino acid residues in its chain length. Now, one more thing which is very important regarding this alpha helix, you can see again here, this is an alpha helical structure, hydrogen example of the secondary structure of protein, stabilized by the hydrogen bonds. And this is one example. You can see we have already discussed the plasma membrane, and while I was discussing about the plasma membrane, I told you there were two different types of proteins were there. One was the peripheral proteins and another was the integral proteins. And integral proteins were those proteins which were present throughout the width of this lipid bilayer. And you can see this is one of the peripheral protein, integral protein, and you can see the multiple alpha helical structure. So this is, you can see one more thing. Up till tertiary structure of protein, it is a single polypeptide chain. Remember one thing. So it is a single polypeptide chain in a helical structure. It is a continuation, and you can see this is being present throughout the width of the lipid bilayer. So peripheral proteins, they do have this alpha helical structures also. So this is for hydrogen bond. What is a hydrogen bond? Hydrogen bond actually is a electrostatic attraction, a non-covalent bond, and it's been formed a proton in one molecule and the electronegative atom in the other molecule. So if we talk about the electronegative atom, we can know that in oxygen of the carbonyl carbon is an electronegative, and the proton in the amide nitrogen is positively charged. So hydrogen bond is the basis of the secondary structure of proteins. Now, alpha helix. We have been through the description of this alpha helix, and you can see the backbone is being stabilized by the hydrogen bonding. Now, this alpha helix can be of right-handed helix or it can be left-handed helix, but in nature it is the right-handed helix which is commonly observed in the protein structure. Got it? And if we see a pitch between the per turn of this alpha helix, via X-ray crystallography, it has been discovered that this one turn of this alpha helix contained at least 3.6 molecules of the amino acid per turn, and it is of 0.054 of the length of this is 0.54 nanometers. So these are the characteristics of the alpha helix, and alpha helix is stabilized by the hydrogen bond. In nature, I have just told you that the right-handed helix are very common, and every turn from, see, the turn start from this amino acid to this, and we see that there are 3.6 number of amino acid residues are present over there. Now, alpha helix structures, you can see one point over here, that proline. We have 20 stranded amino acid, and proline is basically comes in the category of amino acid, not the proper amino acid, and it is the proline which disrupts the alpha helix structures. Okay, so this is our characteristics of alpha helix, and alpha helix are commonly found, observed, as I told you earlier. And examples of alpha helix is alpha keratin, and alpha keratin is present is normally in hair, nails, and that of the skin of the human beings. The second example of the secondary structure of protein is beta pleated sheath. Now, before going to that description, you should know what is a sheath and what is a strand. Actually, a beta strand is nothing but it is a portion of polypeptide chain. Remember, I have told you till tertiary structure, we will just talk about the single polypeptide chain. So a strand is a part of the polypeptide chain, and it may be as from 3 to 10 amino acid long, and these portions are in a fully extended conformation. So first a strand is there, and when multiple strands they combine, they form sheets. So sheets are nothing but they are the multiple number of strands arranged one after another, and they are being laterally stabilized by the hydrogen bond. So beta sheets may contain 2 to 15 strands. So what is the base of beta, the second structure of protein of that beta platelet sheet is the beta strand. Beta strand, again I will repeat, is nothing, part of a polypeptide chain. And multiple beta strands, they form beta sheets, or they are also called beta platelet sheets because they are arranged one after another in the sheet form. Now here, this you can see, this is one strand, okay? What is strand? It is simply a portion of a single polypeptide chain. This is another strand. So multiple strands, when they are being arranged in a sheet form, one after the another, they form beta platelet sheet. And again here, the backbone is stabilized by the hydrogen bonding. The oxygen of the carbonyl carbon will form hydrogen bond with the hydrogen of the amide, hydrogen group of the amide group. So this is a secondary structure. You can see here, this is helical structure, one example of the secondary structure of protein. And an alpha helical structure is observed. Where it is observed? In the skin, nails, and the hair of the in human beings. And these are the sheet arrangement of the single, they see, it is a single polypeptide chain. It is in continuation, but it is arranged in sheets. Now these arrows are actually indicating the direction. You all are very well aware that proteins are, count the number of amino acid in a protein residue, we go from amino group towards the carboxyl group. So arrows are indicating the direction of the residues from amino group towards the carboxyl group. This is another picture of the beta platelet sheet. You can see this is one strand, beta. This is beta strand, this is another beta strand, and this is another beta strand. So multiple strands, they are being bonded by the hydrogen bonding. Now if you see here, you see these rod-like structure, they are peptide bond, but these dotted structure, they are the hydrogen bonding. So backbone in the beta platelet sheet, they again stabilized by the hydrogen bonding. And this hydrogen bonding, if you see, they are okay. Now this beta platelet sheet can be in parallel and anti-parallel direction. These arrows, you can see from here, these arrows are indicating the direction from amino group towards the carboxyl group of this peptide chain. Just remember one more thing, that these strands, they may be the segment of the same polypeptide chain, or they may be the segment from the different polypeptide chain. This is one strand, this is another strand, and here you can see this arrows, they are indicating what? They are indicating the direction of this amino acid residues from amino terminal towards carboxy terminal. So we can see here, when in the parallel beta platelet sheet, you can see the adjacent strands, they are stabilized by the hydrogen bond, but these hydrogen bonds, they are slanting in direction, they are not perpendicular. But if we see in the anti-parallel direction, you can see here the amino group, and here it is the direction of amino acid residues, this is a carboxyl, just opposite to these two strands. Okay, when we see that these two strands, they are being stabilized, you can see the hydrogen bonds are perpendicular to the peptide groups. So there is a difference of direction of the hydrogen bond when we talk about the parallel beta platelet sheet and anti-parallel beta platelet sheet. In anti-parallel beta platelet sheet, you can see the hydrogen bonds, they are perpendicular to the direction of this peptide groups. And you can see one more thing, that here there is a repeating alternating narrow and broad spaces between the hydrogen bond. Between these are two hydrogen bond. Here there's a narrow space, but this is one hydrogen bond, this is another. You can see there is a wide space between the hydrogen bond. So the same pattern is being repeated. Narrow, wide, narrow, wide, narrow, wide. So this is more stable form because the hydrogen bonds, they are perpendicular. in contrast to the parallel beta plate sheet, where we can see the hydrogen bonds are there, but they are slanting in direction. Okay, so this is less stable, this is more stable. So beta plate sheet can be of two types, parallel or anti-parallel beta plate sheets. Got it? Now, protein, a single protein may have these two different types of secondary structure. Again, I will recall secondary structure. Examples of the secondary structures are the alpha helices and the beta plate sheet. So, a protein may have both type of secondary structures in its conformation. You can see here, this is helical structure, and you can see this is the sequence of the amino acid residues in that. So, this is the primary sequence. When they are being arranged in a spiral wave, they are called alpha helix, and these are the beta plated sheets. So, and the amount of these alpha helices and beta plated sheets, they may vary in different proteins, like in myoglobin, which is a example of a tertiary structure of protein, and it is made up of only a single polypeptide chain. It has more than 75% of its conformation in the form of alpha helix, and less than 25% of the this peptide chain is in the form of the beta plate sheet. So one may observe both type of the secondary structure of protein in the same single polypeptide chain, the extended sheet structure as well as the helical structure in the same protein. Now, collagen is an example of this secondary structure of protein, and you all are very well aware that collagen, as far as there is a classification of proteins on the basis of their structure. So collagen is mainly made up of this, it comes under the category of the fibrous proteins, and it is it is composed of multiple alpha helical structure which are being stabilized by cross-linking between the different amino acid residues. I will again repeat here now that here I'm not using the word amino acid, but I am using the word residue, because these amino acids are now being linked by the peptide linkage. And collagen is a component of ground substance, cementing agent, or the connective tissue, and mainly it is present, it is found in bones, muscles, skin, in the walls of the blood vessels, tendons, and the digestive system. So collagen is another example of the secondary structure of protein. Before that, I told you that alpha helix, alpha keratin is an example of the secondary structure of protein. Now, this is a description of this collagen. You can see there are three different strands of a peptide chain, and they have this helical structure, and these collagen strands, they are being stabilized by cross-linking. If you see, just concentrate on the structure of this. This is alpha chain of the, this is one of the alpha helix which is being explained over here. These are the amino acid residues linked by peptide bond. And just look at this. Every third residues in the structure of collagen is glycine. This X is usually lysine, and this is proline. So hydroxyproline and lysine, they are the amino acids which are involved in the cross-linking, and they stabilize the structure of collagen, and this collagen then gives tensile strength to the connective tissue. Now, the tertiary structure of protein, again it is single polypeptide chain. And this tertiary structure of protein, it is a three-dimensional complete folding structure of a protein, where a single polypeptide chain undergo a complete folding state, and it is functional, it is in the compact form and beside hydrogen bonds. If you recall, in the primary structure we have only the peptide bond, in the secondary structure we have the hydrogen bond, but when we say tertiary structure, then other non-covalent bond, they participate in the stabilization of the tertiary structure. But see, this is again, please remember, till tertiary structure it is a single polypeptide chain which is undergoing folding, and when the different amino acids, they come in contact to each other, they form different types of non-covalent bond. The hydrogen bonds are already been discussed. If you see in this single polypeptide chain, when the two cysteine residues, they come in close proximity, they form disulfide bond. And if the two charge amino acids like glutamic acid, which is a negatively charged, or we have a basic amino acid like histidine, when they come in close contact, they form ionic interactions, or they may be the hydrophobic interaction. So a tertiary structure is a three-dimensional, completely folded conformation of a protein, functional protein, okay? And beside hydrogen bond, hydrophobic interactions, disulfide linkages, ionic interaction, they also participate in the stabilization of the tertiary structure of protein. The best example of this see, these are the various bonds which are involved in the stabilization of the tertiary structure of protein, disulfide bond, hydrogen bonds, salt bridges, hydrophobic interaction, ionic interaction. They all help these a single polypeptide chain to assume a tertiary structure, which is a functional state of a protein. Now, this is example of a, and remember, all globular proteins, they are examples of the tertiary structure of protein. Here you can see enzyme pepsin, which is a globular protein, and this is collagen. We have just discussed collagen, the rod-like structure, the fibrous protein, a part of the connective tissue. One more example I can show you, that it is a myoglobin is an example of the tertiary structure of protein, a single polypeptide chain, which is an example of the tertiary structure of protein. Many enzymes, they are also, when a protein is comprised of a single polypeptide chain, it may be an enzyme, it may be an any protein, then they are in the form of the tertiary structure of protein, and there are many enzymes which are examples of the tertiary structure of protein. Now, a quaternary structure is the fourth level of protein structure. This quaternary structure of protein, here either we have two or more than two polypeptide chains in, which are being arranged in close proximity to each other to form a larger aggregate protein complex. See, multiple protein subunits. A protein can be made up of single polypeptide chain, then it is called monomeric protein. When a protein which is made up of multiple subunits, then it is called oligomeric protein. So we can say that a quaternary structure is only observed in the form of the oligomeric proteins, or proteins which have multiple polypeptide chains. So this is the definition of quaternary structure: multiple protein subunits when they interact with each other and arrange themselves to form larger protein complexes, okay? And the final shape is stabilized by, again, these, we have tertiary structure, and these multiple tertiary structures, then they are being arranged in quaternary structures. So again, they are being stabilized by hydrogen bonding, disulfide bridges, and the salt bridges. The example of this quaternary structure of protein, the best example is hemoglobin, enzyme DNA polymerase, ion channels, and beside these certain enzymes which are made up of multi oligomeric units like pyruvate dehydrogenase complex, lactate dehydrogenase complex, or those enzymes which are called isoenzymes, they are come under the category of the quaternary structure of protein. So just please keep in mind that till tertiary structure of protein, it is the only single polypeptide chain which is involved. But when we talk about the quaternary structure, they may be polypeptide chain, maybe two in number, or they may be more than two, and they finally arrange themselves close to each other in a compact aggregate protein complex, then they are called quaternary structure of protein. This is the example of the hemoglobin. You can see here, hemoglobin is comprised of two alpha and two beta globin chains. So you can see here, four different tertiary structure of protein. This is, if one yellow component is one oligomeric protein, single polypeptide chain. This is one tertiary structure of protein. This is another tertiary structure of protein. So we have four different tertiary structure of protein, which are then hydrogen, which are then being arranged to each other by means of other non-covalent bond, and you can see in hemoglobin these are the pockets which are incorporating the heme, which is the prosthetic group for this hemoglobin. And we can see that this prosthetic group can interact with the oxygen, it can interact with the nitric oxide, it can interact with the carbon dioxide. So these are various pockets, but these four different subunits, they are, you can see the two green in, two alpha, two beta globin chain, and they are being stabilized by non-covalent bond. And one partial bond with the characteristic, the partial bond, that is the disulfide bond, okay? So this is the quaternary structure of protein. And again, you can see four different tertiary structure of protein, and they are being arranged in a quaternary form in an oligomeric subunit by means of non-covalent bond, which are stabilizing this protein level. Now what happens that proteins, they may undergo a process that is called denaturation. What happens when these proteins, they are exposed to extremes of temperature, or when they are being exposed to different pH ranges, or they are being treated with the alcohol, or they are being treated with the acids or bases, what happens? If you recall, secondary structure was stabilized by the hydrogen bond, tertiary structure was stabilized by, again, the non-covalent bond, like ionic interaction, the salt bridges, hydrophobic interaction, and then again the quaternary structure was stabilized by the non-covalent bond. So these changes in temperature, in pH, alcohol, acids, bases, and then heavy metals and the reducing agents, they can cause denaturation of protein. When we use this word denaturation of protein, it means all non-covalent bond, they are being broken down except the peptide bond. A peptide bond is a covalent bond, and as I told you while we were discussing the plasma membrane, that a covalent bond is one which requires an enzyme to break it. So non-covalent bond can be broken down once a protein is treated with all these different chemicals, or they have been exposed to varying temperature or to different pH ranges. So denaturation means all non-covalent bond are being disrupted, they are being broken down, only the peptide bond is being there. And you can see here, this is a second, so there is denaturation of protein. The alpha helix structure is being disrupted, and you can see just a single peptide chain remains there. And this one of the examples I can give you, like that you have seen collagen. Collagen is stabilized by hydrogen bonding, the example of the second structure of protein. And you have aapne khaye honge pie. Pie is what? If you go for that pie, when they are being placed at room temperature, they form a gel-like texture or structure. So collagen is converted into gelatin. So gelatin is nothing, but it is the denatured form of the collagen. So denaturation of protein can, and this denaturation will not allow the protein to form its proper functioning, because on the basis of primary structure, protein cannot be functional. For to be functional, either they have to assume the secondary level of protein structure, tertiary or quaternary. So they are no more biologically functional proteins. They are simply assuming or having the primary structure of protein.